A very good morning to you. Welcome to the online service of 28 June 2020. Our call to worship this morning comes from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8. Open with me so that we may read verses 1 to 20. The heading is, Do Not Forget the Lord. Be careful to follow every command I am giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land that the Lord promised on oath to your forefathers. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years, to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. Observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in his ways and revering him. For the Lord God is bringing you into a good land, a land with streams and pools of water, with springs flowing in the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing, a land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large and your silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful deserts, that thirsty and waterless land, with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of the hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the desert, something your fathers had never known, to humble and to test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this one for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant which he swore to your forefathers as it is today. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you today that you will surely be destroyed. Like the nations the Lord destroyed before you, so you will be destroyed for not obeying the Lord your God. May the Lord add blessings to you of his word. Amen. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you, Father, for your goodness, your kindness, your mercy. Thank you for your word and even the reminder which you gave to the Israelites then. Today it is also applicable in our lives. When we increase in our wealth, when we have success, help us to remember that all these things come from you. Apart from you, we are nothing. Help us to believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, for it is only him and him alone where we get our salvation. In his name we pray. Amen. very much for beautiful singing. Beautiful singing is always a good aroma unto the Lord. We shall now go into a time of corporate prayer. There are so many things that you may be looking for, things that you may be needing the help of the Lord. You may also be having some praise-worthy items. All those you can do in a quiet time. But this time, let's put our hearts together and pray to the Lord of Lords. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for taking us this far. Thank you, Father, for your presence even during this time of the pandemic. We pray for those who have lost their loved ones. We think of Busi Maseko. We think of Patricia Mujajati and their sister patients, having lost their mother. Comfort them and the families. We pray for our sister Rosemary, who needs your strength even as she balances your work life, your home life, and spiritual life. We pray also, Father, for the elderly. We think of those who are struggling even to meet with family and how lonely they can be. We also pray, Father, for our church leadership. Thank you, Father, for the elders, the deacons, the administration staff, as they look ahead, having heard of the government's new directive that we can meet as your people. Help them, Father, to find the practical ways that can be applied and that may be used so that we continue to glorify you. Thank you, Father, for your goodness and mercy. Even during this time, we thank you for your provisions. We thank you even for the word. Yes, we may not be meeting in a way that would prefer, but even online, it has taught us to depend on you. And today, as we listen to your word, how we pray, Father, that you may use the preacher to be an instrument that will rebuke us, that will teach us, that correct us, that encourages us, and that brings us closer to you. May this word be alive and practical in our lives. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Mukai, tsiguru nesimba murire mukai ukai watendi shewenyu mirirai nesimba rake roka warumesi mukai nenu mito chipinai mukai mukai batenzi anosoperao mafumo pando pasi patai wanao wakundi vado piwa Corona ikweyo wachazo bata ushe usinga periko.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I've found my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you, oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Your grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. When I cannot sing, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, still praying as I onward bound, Lord plant my feet on higher ground, Lord lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay, though some may dwell where these are bound. My prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan starts at me ahead. For faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till heaven I'm found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. We thank God so much for today, as the Lord has allowed us to be able to have this service online. We continue to pray for our country. We continue to pray for everyone. Today we are looking at 1 Timothy chapter 6 from verse 5 to 10. So allow me to pray so that we can commit ourselves to the Lord as we hear His word. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you so much that you have given me this opportunity to share the word of God with brethren. I pray that for the time we are hearing this word, we may seek to be more like Jesus. Help us that we may come to the knowledge of the word of truth and to repentance, that your name may be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. From 1 Timothy chapter 6, as we get into verse 5, we realize that the Bible is warning us to withdraw ourselves from people of corrupt minds, destitute of the truth, who are supposing that gain is godliness, because these people have erred away from the wholesome word of the Lord Jesus. So today, we want to look at this portion of Scripture and look at four parts about this portion of Scripture that come out of this portion from verse 6 to verse 10. The first part is the role of money and wealth. So we'll quickly look at that. And then number 2, we will look at the start of deception. Take note that the Bible is saying in verse 3, if any man teach otherwise, so the deception that makes people to teach otherwise, where is it coming from? And number 3, we are going to look at the believer's position and the supreme focus. Take note that verse 6 there says that godliness with contentment is great gain. Therefore, those are the three parts we are going to look at. And in conclusion, we are going to just look at the final charge from the Word of God. So quickly, my brothers and sisters, let us look at the issue of wealth. And by that, I just want to start right from the beginning. We need to read from Genesis chapter 1 and verse number 1. We want to start right from the beginning. The Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Right from that point, we want to recognize something. The heaven and the earth, they are created of God. Therefore, the wealth and the fullness of everything that is on earth, it comes from God. Let that be clear in every person's mind, because that understanding is important in how we look at wealth, is important in how we look at money, is important in how we look at life, is important in how we look at possessions, because everything belongs to the Lord. He is the one who created. So wealth is there, but God is above wealth. So that it makes us understand that we should not worship a creature. We should worship the Creator who is above wealth. And the next scripture we want to read is from Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2 verse 15, which says, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. We want to understand from this scripture that God has created the heavens and the earth, and they belong to Him. Everything belongs to Him. Even as we read in 1 Timothy chapter 6, that we brought nothing into the world. We understand, therefore, that God took man who had nothing and put him into a garden which God Himself had made. And what was man's responsibility in that garden? Let's repeat verse 15. And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. So man's responsibility in the garden was not to accumulate anything. Man's responsibility in the garden was to dress it, was to keep it. God was giving him responsibility. Man was given a trust so that man became a steward to keep the garden and to be able to dress it, therefore to make it better so that the garden will look great. That's man's responsibility. And that is important in a believer's life, so that a believer looks at wealth, looks at everything and says, it does not belong to me. I am a steward who has been given these things to dress it and to tend it But the real owner is the Lord, to whom everything belongs. So that is important. The role of money and wealth is that everything belongs to the Lord. I am given as a steward. And lest other people think that by this sermon we are saying believers should not make money, let us turn to Isaiah 48, verse 17. Thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord thy God, which teacheth thee to profit, which leadeth thee by the way that thou shouldest to go. So the Lord himself looks at the children of Israel and he says, I am the one who teaches you to profit. I am the one who gives you everything that you have. Because also where we read in our call to worship in Deuteronomy chapter 8, it is the Lord who was moving them and who moved them to the land of Canaan, which the Lord himself was making them to have and to possess. It is the Lord who teaches you to profit. And we know also in Proverbs chapter 13 verse 22, the Bible says that a good man leaves a good legacy to his children. So the Bible does not condemn wealth, so to speak, but the Bible speaks so that a man understands that God is above money, not money above God. It is important for us to realize that. So that's the first part of our sermon. Money and wealth is important, but under God. Number two, where did this deception, where people love money, where did this deception come from? Quickly, let us turn as we read our Bibles to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. Let us turn to that portion of the scripture and read. The Bible says, and now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. This is the beginning of deception. We can read other scriptures like John chapter 8, verse 44, where the serpent is clearly indicated in the Bible as the father of lies, lying straight to the woman, contending with the word of God. And we can read in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, the devil goes about blinding the eyes of them who do not believe, so that the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ will not shine upon them. The beginning of deception is in Satan. And this deception is in blinding people so that they will not see the word of God, and they will not recognize God. They will not worship God. They will rebel against God. And that goes and permeates into every avenue of life, such that even with money, the devil now turns the tables. The Lord teaches you and he blesses you. But then the blessing, according to the devil, becomes more important than the God who blesses you. So Satan is blinding the eyes of people so that they don't see God. They don't worship God, but they worship a blessing. They worship the wealth. They worship the money. They begin to love money. And then when they love money and all wealth, they pursue money in such a way that there is no God who ever exists. And therefore, it leads them to every form of sin. It leads them to prostitution in order to get money. It leads them to corruption in order to get money. It leads them to lying in order to get money. It leads them to become con men in order to get money. The devil blinding people so that they now worship money, and money has become their God. And by all means, they want to just get at money. May God deliver us from this satanic blinding, which makes us all look at money as the supreme instead of looking at God. That deception comes from Satan. For the love of money is the root of all evil, because Satan turns it and it becomes our worship and we disregard God. The Bible teaches us that it is not so with believers. The Bible teaches us that in verse 6, godliness with contentment is great gain. So what should be the believer's supreme focus and his supreme position? In verse number 6, the Bible teaches us that godliness with contentment is great gain. The believer looks at his life and says, wealth is important. Wealth can make me even bring honor to God when I give it to him. But wealth is not my supreme focus. My supreme focus is godliness. I want to be like him. I want to be what he wants me to be. I want to obey him. I want his word to fill me. And in Romans chapter 12, the Bible tells us that we be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Our focus is now God and not money. Our focus is him and not money. And we don't seem to pursue all these deceptions that come from the evil one. Our contentment is godliness. And why do we get contented with godliness? Because Jesus, when we read in the Bible, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. He himself is the one who satisfies us. And why are we content with food and raiment? We know that with food, when we eat Jesus as our bread of life, we become content. And nothing in our lives will be lacking, because in Jesus we have the fullness of what God wants. In Jesus we are complete. Therefore, beloved believers, our supreme pursuit is that godliness that makes us like Jesus, that makes us desire to be like his son. Then, when we are like that, we bring honor to the name of God. And we will be content even with raiment. Hallelujah. This is very interesting. Now, raiment is the clothing that we put on. Raiment is these things that we put on. It is interesting that in the book of Philippians, the Apostle Paul says that he counts everything but dung, so that he may take hold of that which Christ has already taken hold of him, not having his own righteousness, but the righteousness that is by faith in Christ. So we want to be clothed with a blanket and a righteousness that comes from Christ. We want to be clothed with Christ's righteousness. We hunger after Christ-likeness. And we will only be content when we have the word of God and we have a righteousness of Christ. May God help us to make that our supreme pursuit and our supreme focus, so that we will not be deceived by the evil one and all these teachings that come nowadays that make us pursue after riches and many things without focusing on God himself, the giver of those riches. And finally, brethren, as a final charge, may I ask all of us that we really ask ourselves in our lives, that are we pursuing righteousness? Are we pursuing to be clothed by a righteousness that comes from Jesus? Are we fully surrendered so that we do not have our own righteousness, our own holiness, but a righteousness and a holiness, a truth that is filled with Jesus, so that his name will be honored on earth? This is our supreme core, our supreme focus, and not money. Many of these people who have pursued money, they have ended up in their lives with a lot of sorrows, because riches by their nature, they fly away. I want to conclude by reading from Proverbs chapter 23, verse 5, so that we read what the word of God says and hear from the word of God what the Bible says about wealth and riches. Wilt thou set thine eyes upon that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings. They fly away as an eagle toward heaven. Brethren, let us set our eyes on that which is going to last forever. For this is certain, we brought nothing on earth, and we are not going to take anything with us. We will not take our riches when we go to heaven. They are not needed in those streets of God. They are not needed where Christ is the Lamb of God. They are not needed in that economy where God is. Riches, they fly away. If they don't fly away while you are still here on earth, be sure, my brothers, that when the time comes for each one of us to take that journey, when the time comes to meet the Master, riches are not going to be on the table. What is going to be on the table is godliness and contentment in Christ, a righteousness that we get in Christ. May the Lord help us to surrender ourselves fully to Christ Jesus, who himself is our supreme focus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us pray that the Lord will help us in our lives to be transformed so that we focus on Christ, the bread of life. We focus on Christ, our righteousness, who clothes us with his own grace. Let us pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your truth. Thank you that Jesus is the bread of life. Jesus is our righteousness. Jesus is our supreme focus. Jesus is our eternal promise. And in him, we are complete. Help us to surrender to him. To the glory of his name we pray. Amen.
There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. None else could heal all our soul's diseases. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. No friend like him is so high and holy. No, not one. No, not one. And yet no friend is so mean. No, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one, no, not one. Savior given. No, not one. No, not one. Will he refuse us a home in heaven? No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day. No, not one, no, not one. There's not an hour that he did not near us. No, not one, no, not one. No night so dark that his love can't cheer us. No, not one.
Brothers, let us receive benediction from the Word of God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14, even as we walk into this world, distorted by the devil, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen.